Good. Wow. Bad. Wow. Heaven. Wow. Hell. Wow. Freedom. Wow. Bondage. Wow. Clarity. Wow. Confusion. Wow. Good. Wow. Bad. Wow. Truth. Wow. Lies. Wow. Light. Wow. Darkness. Wow. Good. Wow. Bad. Wow. Peace. Wow. Chaos. Wow. Bliss. Wow. Despair. Wow. Good. Wow. Bad. Wow. Practice is good and bad. Opposites. Use the most extreme good and the most extreme bad. One evaluation for all of that. And what this does, it frees you from your thinking. Thinking requires two thoughts, not one. If you just have one thought, you're not thinking. You have a thought, but you're not thinking. The problem is when we have two thoughts, then hope and fear, we feel insecure, on and on. Anyway, that's an explanation. So practice first, explanation as an adjunct to practice is always the way that it is. We have it backwards. We say first explanation, and if we explain good enough, then we'll practice. There's no explanation that's good enough that is going to cause anyone to practice. So practice is will, your will. You must have the will to do it. Otherwise, you just continue to curse yourself. And when you practice, the clarity that you have will be sufficient. Okay, sufficient. Way better than any explanation. Explanation just obfuscates clarity, actually. But we're so addicted to explanation and thinking that we don't want to just give no explanation. That's too severe for you. But keep in mind, it's only explanation is just sophisticated confusion. It's just sophisticated confusion. But practicing, when you practice like this, stilling your thinking, you will see clearly, oh, this is what's happened. And the clarity will be greater than any explanation, for sure. So this morning I had just found tremendous clarity. And I say, well, how do I explain it? Well, you can't. You cannot explain clarity. Explaining clarity is just putting clouds before the sun. That's all it is. But what I'm telling you for sure, if you practice, this great clarity will come and it'll be sufficient. You'll say, oh, yeah, this is great. This is sufficient. I get it. I see it. It's like a blind person seeing. Okay, there's no amount of explanation to a blind person that's as good as seeing. Right? If you explain a street to them and explain a busy, there's a bunch of cars zooming around chaotically and this. The blind person will say, oh, okay, I kind of get it. A bunch of cars, chaotic. But if you open your eyes and you see, don't you feel a lot more secure than if you just are going on an explanation? Well, there's all this chaos going on. not very helpful for a blind person, is it? So when you practice this, the clarity will arise for you. Prove it to yourself. It will be there for sure. As it was for me this morning. I had a horrible dream. And then I began to practice. I didn't lose my faith. I said, let me just go back to this practice. And then suddenly, wow, massive clarity arose for me. Massive. But it's not overwhelming. Clarity is not overwhelming. It's explanation. It's when you try to explain it that it feels overwhelming. So, oh my God, there's so many clouds. How do I arrange these clouds? Well, how does arranging clouds enable you to see the sun? It's like we're arranging all these different clouds in different patterns, but we still can't see the sun. That's what words and explanation and thinking do. Okay, it's just a form of self-medication, really. Medicating ourselves. Anyway, I had this long morning practice, which was extremely profound. Now, keep in mind that all gurus are one. All one. There's just one guru. Many guises, but just one guru. And they all say the same thing, practice. Anandamayi Ma, what did she say to everyone? Very simple, you must practice. What did Ram Maharshi say to everyone? You must practice. Okay? Longchenpa, you must practice. Jesus, you must practice. It's the same with all of them. You must practice. They say, Mama, give me an explanation. She'd say, well, first, I want you to promise me something, that you'll practice. You see, we've made all these vows to ourselves to be loyal to arrogance. So we think we're bound by vows. But how can the Son of God vow anything? The Son of God is created free. Vowing itself is arrogance. Okay? Vowing itself is arrogance. And yet, we're so addicted to vowing. We're so addicted to thinking. We're so addicted to explanation, medication. The whole world is just medication. It's just an attempt to medicate ourselves. Breathing is medication. Eating is medication. Thinking is medication. All this is an attempt at self-medication to try and fixate the mind, to try and fixate the mind. Try to be happy with insecurity. It's just medication. But we vowed to do all this. We come into this world because we made all these vows. Every time we step ourselves down into even more darkness, we vow that we will not rest until we find the right medication. So we go into this realm of medication. The world is just this vast ocean of medication. And so we're seeking the right medication. And it's difficult to explain this, but you can see this clearly. You can see it clearly. To explain it, it's never clear. Explanations are never clear. Even the most excellent explanation is never clear. So it's better to practice than to listen to any explanation. Even Longchenpa, as well as he can explain, it's infinitely better to just do this good, wow, bad, wow. Flatten out all thinking, so you just have one thought, which is wow, or yes, or okay, good, okay, bad, okay, truth, okay, lies, okay. Just one thought. It's better to do that practice than to listen to any explanation from any guru, from Ananda Mayama. It's better to practice than to listen to any explanation of Ananda Mayama. Or Jesus. Okay. Everybody's spending all their time listening to explanations of Jesus. So I'm reading the Bible. So it's right here. Jesus explaining. This is the explanation. So it's better to just say good, wow, bad, wow, good, wow, bad, wow, good, wow. 10 seconds of practice is better than listening to any explanation, actually. Just 10 seconds of practice is better than listening to any explanation of Sri Sri Ananda Maimar, Longchenpa, Jesus, Pabasama, Manjushri, Ramaharshi, Jamyang Khenchi Choki Lodro. 10 seconds of practice is better than listening to any explanation of Ramaharshi, or even looking at his picture. 10 seconds, and yet nobody will do this here. I've had, what, I don't know, maybe one person, maybe two. I don't know if anyone's practiced. I come to this world with the gift of practice, which is the guru gift, and nobody will do it. Nobody will do it. Maybe there's been one, maybe zero, that kind of thing. Maybe two, maybe zero. I don't know. Nobody said that they're really practicing. Exactly, you know, not really opposites. That good, wow, bad, wow. Freedom, wow. Slavery, wow. Heaven, wow. Hell, wow. Heaven, wow. Hell, wow. Peace of God, acceptance of peace of God, wow. Abandoning the peace of God, wow. Heaven, wow. Abandoning heaven, wow. Freedom, wow. Abandoning freedom, wow. So just 10 seconds of practicing like this is better than listening a lifetime of listening to explanations. Because that doesn't work. It's going back to your wheelchair. You say, okay, let's go back to our wheelchair. Now you're standing up, stand up for 10 seconds, and then go back in your wheelchair. Okay, that's fine. But if you don't stand up at all, it's not fine. You haven't gotten anywhere. So the characteristic of this realm, which is just a massive hope of medication here, everything, a world is always a world of medication. That's all it is. That's all it is. The mind trying to medicate itself, trying to find a condition for itself. Maybe this medication will give me a condition. So this whole world is a world of hope, that there's medication. We come here, so we vow to come here. We vow. All these vows get in the way of us practicing. We say, well, I can't practice. I vowed not to practice. You see, we make, really, all vows are boiled down to just one. It's, I vow not to practice, but to continue to seek condition for myself. Seek a condition for myself. That's all it is, which is total arrogance, which really meaning I vow to change God. But since we can't change God, the vow is meaningless. But nobody here wants to break their vow, so they refuse to practice. This is every guru who comes in meets the same situation here. Everyone refuses to practice here. Super rare that anyone will break their vow. So they demand explanations instead of practice. That's what happened to you. They hijack your intention here. You come into the world hijacks you. It says, no, give us explanations because we refuse to practice. And if you demand we practice, then you're terrible. You're worse than God. I mean, we hate God. We'll hate God. Well, we're already hating God. By vowing to change God, we're trying to kill God. But it has no effect. So a cause without an effect is not a cause at all. So really, there's no hatred at all, because it has no effect on God, you see. So nothing's happened in that regard. However, we still continue to refuse to practice. So just explain that. I mean, just medicate my mind, just medicate it. I feel so terrible. Now we think we feel terrible. That too is a medicate. We're medicating our medication. It never ends. But you can see this for yourself. If 10 seconds of practice, a minute of practice, and you keep expanding your practice, you will see for yourself what's going on. And then you'll say, I don't need any explanation. I can see it. I'm not blind anymore. So the goal is to not give explanations to blind people. It's to free us from blindness through practice. It's useless to give explanation. The blind says, well, I'm still blind, but then the explanations really don't work so well. So give me more explanation. So, you know, I left Facebook because nobody would practice. They just said, give me more explanation. I need more explanation. It's useless. It's just inducement into medication. Everybody's self-medicating on Facebook with gurus and advice, refusing to practice. Doesn't matter how much advice of Rama Maharshi you listen to. If you refuse to practice, you're still blind. You'll still be blind. Only clarity will free you. You see it. You say, oh, so that's it. I see it. But I can't explain it. No, you cannot explain clarity. That's medicating clarity. Explaining clarity is medicating clarity. But we're so used to this that if I don't do that, Ram Maharshi didn't, you know, do that very much. He was just silent. He said, you want to see it? Practice. I assure you, if you practice, you will see it clearly. And it'll be sufficient to you. It won't bother you. You'll say, oh, I'm fine. I see it. Seeing it, it's like a person opening their eyes and say, oh, yeah, I could function fine. I don't have to be blind. The only trouble I have was being blind. But not being blind is no problem at all. I could function just fine. I see. Yeah. But the only way to do that is to flatten your thinking. Flatten your thinking is just evaluating. It's the only way. You have to practice. And so there'll never be a guru who tells you don't have to practice. Not a real guru. There'll be all sorts of forms of medication that you might label guru. But if they don't insist that you practice and advise you, you must practice, and you don't practice, you will continue in your abominable misery. It's a misery that can't even be explained. You think if the misery is explained, you'll be okay. No. That's just more medication. Hell is like endless medication. But no matter what medicine you take, it doesn't cure your problem. And so you seek for more medication. And that all has horrible side effects. That's hell. And this is what we're in. We're in an infinite array of medication, all of them making us bitter and make terrible side effects, and none of them actually curing our problem. Our problem is we don't have any conditions. The mind cannot create any conditions for itself. And our problem is familiarity with seeking conditions and familiarity is the problem, really. That's the only problem we have. And so God knows this, has given us one condition, peace of God, that frees us from all other conditions. So we can still feel like we have a condition, it's just that we can't think we have a condition. Okay, so this is very important to get this. This is the, like, one explanation that leads you to practicing, if you will hear the explanation, you see. But if you insist on more explanation, then it won't work. It has to be very simple. So you have to keep trending in this direction and just try 10 seconds of practice. But very few will even give 10 seconds of practice in their whole life. Most never practice in their entire life. They just keep medicating. Breathing is medicating. Eating is medicating. Everything about the body this needs is just medicating. It's self-medication. So I've got to give the mind conditions, but I feel so insecure. Where's the medicine for that? Let me an explanation. And again, you have to see this. I saw it this morning, but I can't quite convey it. Maybe at some point I'll be able to, you know, give a little better conveyance to you. But it's the same. If you don't practice, you'll never get it. You'll never see it. So no explanation will be sufficient. It's still medication. Now, I could give you light medication, very light medication, but still, that's not the answer for you. The peace of God is the answer for you, because it's such a light medication. The way to get the peace of God is to flatten out your thinking by using just one thought for everything, and practice one thought on good and bad, good opposites. That's very powerful to do it with opposites, extreme opposites. If you're not thinking about either polarity of good and bad, all the stuff in between, you won't be thinking about that either. So the way to practice is on extreme opposites. Heaven, wow. Hell, wow. Heaven, wow. Hell, wow. No conditions, wow. Conditions, wow. And when you flatten out your thinking into one thought about all the opposites, then everything in between is flattened out also. Whereas if you don't do this and only work on all the stuff in between, the severity of the opposites will keep generating all this in-betweenness, between hope and fear. Hope and fear is what generates all this medication of thinking. Thinking is just evaluating as medication. Trying to medicate your fear. Of what? Of no conditions. We're medicating our fear of no conditions. But no conditions is reality, and we can never change that. So medicating our fear of no conditions goes on infinitely without any success. And so we're seeking more medication, another world, this world, this world, another compound, another drug, another thought. It's all self-medication, thinking, evaluating. So the peace of God is such that you can't evaluate it, but you still feel like it's a condition. But there's no other There's no second. It's like one medication, but there's no other medication you can apply to it. You cannot apply, if you try to have a second medication, you lose sight of the peace of God entirely. And now you have two medications, but neither are the peace of God. See, that's the way the peace of God is. So the one, if you try to apply a medication to the peace of God, it vanishes. Not because it vanishes, but we abandon it, actually. It doesn't. It seems to vanish, but we have to understand we've abandoned it. Because we're now evaluating it. So as soon as we try to evaluate the peace of God, we abandon it. So we must get familiar with flattening our thinking. That's what all the gurus say. You got to stop thinking. Well, yeah, easy to say, right? But I mean, they tell us how to do it. It's just that we don't do it. So we medicate their advice and we say, well, they told us to stop thinking. No, they told us how to practice. Rama said, I, meaning flatten all thinking by just one thought. Well, he said, use the I. You can use anything. You can use okay. Okay. Heaven, okay. Hell, okay. Heaven, okay. Hell, okay. Heaven, okay. Hell, okay. Accepting the peace of God, okay. Abandoning the peace of God, okay. Accepting the peace of God, okay. Abandoning the peace of God, okay. So he just said, you have to use one thought. He said, use one stick to stir all the other sticks till they're burnt, and that stick will be burnt also. But he told me, I said, Rama, I'm not using the I, I'm using wow. And he said, that's perfectly fine. It's just as effective as using I. As long as you use one thought and adhere to that one thought, it will have the same effectiveness as using I. He told me that directly. And at that point, I realized, oh, okay, I get it. And I'm telling you directly, you can use okay or ah. Heaven, ah, wow, ah. Just one medicine, one evaluation, but adhere to that and work on opposites, extreme opposites. This will flatten out your thinking, your evaluating. You will get used to not evaluating. You will get used to not evaluating. And Anandamayi Ma says, try to make your practice 24 hours a day, continuous. If you do that, she said, very soon, the peace of God will be upon you. Very soon, actually. Which is true. If we did this all the time, the peace of God would dawn upon us very quickly. And I saw, really, I was doing it, I was working on it, and I stopped just short of it. But I said, if I did it in like 4 days, in a, you know, continuously, it would dawn on you that quickly. But no, you know, who's going to do that? Very few. You don't need to do it in 4 days. You could do it in 4 years, like Nisargadatta Maharaj, if you want to. Or you can do it more quickly. But if you don't practice, you're not going to do it at all. It won't dawn upon you at all. And you might say, oh, good. But no, because the peace of God is still feels like a condition. It still is a condition, actually. But it's such a subtle condition. You can't see it. You can't think of it. You can't practice it. You can't analyze it. You can't medicate it. Because you don't know what it is to medicate. And yet it still feels like a condition. So we feel, well, I'm okay, but it's just that, what if I need to medicate this? I don't know how to medicate it. Because we're used to medicating medication. Just like you go to a doctor, they give you medicine for something, right? A powerful medicine. And you got all these side effects. And you go back to them and say, doc, and they say, oh, yeah, I know it's got side effects. But we have a medicine to treat the side effects. Now, my doctor told me, he said, look, this is the way all medicines are. You got to understand this. You start down the road of medicine, you're always going to add more and more and more. So he said, it's not good to start with any medicine, actually. Because one medicine, always side effects. It doesn't work totally. You don't feel, and more medicines. And before you know it, you're on 20 medicines a day, right? And even that doesn't work. But really, we're on billions of medications. Everyone here, billions. And medication applied to medication, applied to medication, applied to medication, infinitely, infinite regress this way. That's how it is. That's hell. We're in hell. A mental hell is what we're in, a mental hell. But with this one medication, the peace of God, you could think of it as a medication. With this medication, there's no way to apply another medication to it. It's unique in that regard. Because there's nowhere where it isn't. There's nowhere where it isn't. And yet you can't, it's imperceptibly gentle and soft. And so you will feel like you can't evaluate it, meaning apply a medication. Evaluation is medication. You say, well, there's no way to evaluate this. And yet I still feel it's an evaluation, but I can't see any way to evaluate it. I can feel it's like it's equal evaluation everywhere. So it's an evaluation, but there's no way to evaluate it. I can't apply. And so you say, well, what if it has side effects that I don't know how to evaluate it? So you start freaking out. So we have to work directly on the peace of God as the topic, you see, in order to resolve our troubles. We cannot avoid this topic. This has to be the central topic. And looking at it, because we will not be able to, you cannot evaluate it. And then we panic, because you say, well, what you know, I need to know what the side effects are, so I know how to medicate the side effects. We're so addicted to side effects and medicating the side effects. Of course, the side effects are just, is insecurity, always. Because we can't give the mind conditions. And we're afraid of no conditions, so we feel insecure. Inherently, right? We feel, since we vowed to give the mind conditions, we're so used to trying, no conditions is like an abyss to us. We think it's like an abyss. So we feel insecure. And so that insecurity, we try to medicate it, and that just makes it worse. We try to give a condition to a condition, to a condition, to a condition, to a condition. But none of those are conditions. They're just hope for a condition and fear that there won't be one. So we keep treating hope to hope. And that just gives, the fear still there, so more hope. Fear still there, more hope. So we're used to evaluating evaluations. So I evaluate an evaluation, and then I apply another evaluation to the evaluation of the evaluation, and then evaluation to the evaluation of the evaluation of the evaluation, and infinite regress, and that's hell. That's hell. And so we're so used to that, that we don't want to be without any evaluation at all. We're so scared. So the peace of God is still an evaluation. But it's one evaluation that says, equally, I don't need to evaluate any of this. That's my last final evaluation. It's everywhere. And there's no insecurity with that. So the insecurity we feel is the habit of evaluating. We say, well, what if this doesn't work? Or what if this breaks? How do I fix it? Or what if I lose it? What if it vanishes? How do I get it back? And so all these insecurities keep arising. So we have to work on these insecurities directly. And assure ourselves this will not leave us. It's everywhere equally, the peace of God. It never tarnishes, it never rusts, it never corrodes, it never breaks, never diminishes, it never abandons us. It's there permanently. It will remain there permanently until all evaluations have finally chosen this one final evaluation. And only when we're completely comfortable with just one evaluation and not evaluating, which is thinking, one thought instead of thinking. Only when everyone is completely familiar and calm and comfortable with that, so finally they're then easily able to accept reality, it will remain there permanently until, and then when it's not needed anymore, it will remain as a blessing for all creation. But in order to accept reality, which is no conditions at all for the mind, we have to stop thinking, evaluating. We have to get used to not thinking. But trying to stop all thinking and also realize there are no conditions at all is too severe for us. We're scared, too scared of it. So we won't do that. We could, but we won't do it. So that's why God gave us the Holy Spirit as one evaluation. The peace of God, one evaluation, covers it all. One evaluation settles it all. So this has to be the topic of explanation. Otherwise, we're just spinning our wheels and getting nowhere, actually. It's too feeble. Our approach is too feeble. And the world of evaluating or self-medication, which is all the world is, will just sweep us away. Sweep us away. So I say, do it for 10 seconds. Will anyone even do it for 10 seconds? Maybe nobody in the whole world will do it even for 10 seconds. That's how bad the world is. It's so addicted to medicating. We say, but when we practice this way, it feels like we're medicating, doesn't it? Heaven, wow. Hell, wow. Heaven, wow. We're applying an evaluation to this, so we still feel like we're applying evaluation to it. Okay? So you feel okay. You feel, I'm still medicating myself. Yeah, heaven, wow. Hell, wow. Heaven, wow. Hell, wow. But then we feel like an effect, like this is powerful. And we say, well, this is the most powerful medication I've ever experienced. Because I'm actually feeling something that's like amazing. It's like, holy cow, this is amazing. I don't know what it is I'm feeling, but it feels really very hopeful. There's some sort of like steady hope. There's some sort of steady hope there. You become aware there's some sort of steady hope there is what happens. And you say, wow. So this 10 seconds, you know, you'll experience a trace of this. There's a steady hope. Huh. Where'd that come from? Why? How come I haven't seen this before? I like that. But what if I lose it? You know, and then you're back evaluating. I got to find some medication to medicate that steady hope. And they say, wait a minute, if it's steady, why do I need to medicate it? And so then you'll bring yourself back to practice. This is how it goes. So the path is not just totally smooth. Fears arise again. But you will feel, you say, wait a minute. Hold on, I don't need to go into thinking. This is the steady. What do I need thinking for? Why do I need to medicate it? If this medication works for my insecurity, why do I need to seek a whole bunch of other medications to medicate it? The side effects. There may not be any side effects, which is insecurity. Well, then you say, but I won't be evaluating. But I'll still have evaluation. Yeah. It's just equal evaluation for everything. Smooth, all smoothed out. I won't need thinking. I won't need thinking, but I'll still have an evaluation. So I'm not totally seeing that there's no conditions at all. I see just one condition, and none other, no other. So I still have one evaluation and one condition. So I still feel like my comfort zone. I still feel in my comfort zone. But I have to get used to not thinking. Otherwise, I'll say, hey, I'm not thinking. And say, well, how do I start thinking? Well, start looking for start imagining that, well, what if this breaks? What if I lose it? What if it vanishes? What if it abandons me? What ifs? You go into what ifs. And then immediately you're thinking again. And then you've abandoned the peace of God. You've abandoned it. So I would say, for me, it seems like the most powerful practice is to say, I've accepted the peace of God. Wow. I've abandoned the peace of God. Wow. I've accepted the peace of God. I've abandoned the peace of God. If you want to really go fast, this, to me, this feels like this is really the fast track. But you can only take so much of it at a time. So it's easy if you want to practice in a lesser way, like good, wow, bad, wow, good, wow, bad, wow. And you can do that maybe for an hour, you know, quite a bit longer time. Okay, which is fine. That's effective too. But if you want to go really fast, and it's not a bad idea to go really fast right now because of the massive self-medication that's coming in this world. It's exponentially growing. The amount of self-medicating that's taking place in this world is growing exponentially, and is about to take a quantum leap. So we need to take a quantum leap in our practicing of not medicating. Really, we do. And this is no joke. I'm very serious. We need to take that. So to take a quantum leap in your practicing, maybe you have been practicing a little bit, you feel. Take a quantum leap. You can say, acceptance of the peace of God, wow. Abandoning the peace of God, wow. Accepting the peace of God, wow. Abandoning the peace of God, wow. Accepting the peace of God, wow. Abandoning the peace of God, wow. Accepting the peace of God, wow. Abandoning the peace of God, wow. Accepting the peace of God, wow. Abandoning the peace of God, wow. Accepting the peace of God, wow. Abandoning the peace of God, wow. Accepting the peace of God, wow. Abandoning the peace of God, wow. Accepting the peace of God, wow. Abandoning the peace of God, wow. Now, that was like 10 or more. So I would suggest doing it 10 times. That's powerful enough. You will feel the burn. Now, this is an after effect that goes away just with patience. So to medicate the burn, you just be patient. Okay? So there is one after effect of this practice, because this is not the peace of God. The peace of God has no after effects. But we're practicing to get to the peace of God, and that still has an after effect. I call it the burn. And to medicate the burn, you just be patient. Non-action. You medicate the burn with non-action. Okay? So we're really honing in on the peace of God, which we will need that, the peace of God, to not get swept up in a quantum leap in self-medication. We're about to take, the fourth dimension is a quantum leap in self-medication is what it is, where we open up vast new vistas of self-medication, which is really hell. So we expanding the vistas of hell is what the fourth dimension really is. We want to go to the fifth dimension, which is the peace of God. So 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4 is hell. It's the fourth dimension is vast new vistas of self-medicating, which is, you know, super complexity of evaluating and thinking. And then we have computers trying to automate our thinking and evaluating. And of course, we're totally afraid that the computers might break. So we have massive fear with that. Massive fear, massive dread, massive concern, horrible concern. The more computers we have, the more anxiety we get. That's true. Because we think that our hope is invested in now automating our evaluating and to come up with ever new combinations of medication. Right? That's what they're doing. You know, snipping genomes, you know, all this stuff. It's just more of the same. And yet, what if the computers fail? What if we have a power outage? What if, you know, there's a glitch? Then, oh my God, all our evaluation is not working. So we become slaves to computers. Slaves. You know, like worshipers and fearful worshipers. lavish, anxiety-driven, fearful worshipers of computers and automation and machinery. So machinery is just opening up more and more vistas of really anxiety. Yeah. Ultimately, you'll have computers simulating chaos, and ultimately total chaos, trying to scare the mind into accepting conditions. And yet, no matter how you try to frighten the mind still cannot create conditions for itself. You will find that out. All forms are apparent forms of self-medication. This whole world is nothing but our expression of the desire to self-medicate. And we're evaluating the medications here. Is that dirt medication? Is that rock medication? Maybe it is some sign of medication. You know, maybe I can medicate with this tree. Maybe I can, this flower is medication for me. And, you know, this breath is medication. This food is medication. It's all an attempt to medicate away fear. The fear of no conditions. And no conditions is reality. So we're fearing reality, and reality never changes. So self-medicating like that won't work, except God understands it won't work. So he gave us one evaluation to smooth out all others. And in this way, we stop thinking, you see. But we still have an evaluation. So it's still not reality. The peace of God is still not reality, okay? But it enables us to stop thinking. And to stabilize and not evaluating, to stabilize. Now, we can get a glimpse of the peace of God. But then we go back to say, what if? And then we start evaluating it. Say, evaluating, how can I treat this? See, that's our habit. Well, how can I, whatever we get, we say, okay, I got this, but how can I treat this? How can I medicate this? I got this medication, but how am I going to medicate that? So our mind never stops thinking, you see. But in the peace of God, the mind stops thinking. You say, I don't need to medicate this. This works. This works. I don't feel fear anymore. I don't feel insecurity anymore. But then we go into, well, what if it stops? So that's why we need to practice acceptance of peace of God, abandonment of the peace of God. We never leave the peace of God. We can only abandon it back into thinking. See, thinking is not leaving, it's abandoning. So this is the most crucial distinction, I believe, there can be. The distinction between leaving and abandoning. In abandoning, we turn away from it entirely, instantly. And what we do then, we label it as a memory, thinking we still have it. And then immediately we feel insecure, so we have immediately another thought to treat it. And that doesn't work. And then we have another thought to treat that thought. And so immediately we're back into thinking. As soon as we abandon the peace of God, we're immediately back into thinking, immediately. But we don't realize that we've accepted a label and an evaluation of that label together. We've gone right back into evaluating. That's abandonment. We think we're leaving, but we don't. We're abandoning it. So if the clearer we could, the more we can just trend to looking at this, the closer we get to the peace of God. It's a quantum leap, actually, in just focusing on this. So I abandoned Facebook because I needed to take a quantum leap. And I need to showcase to others the necessity to take a quantum leap. They're not taking a quantum leap there. They're just medicating ceaselessly medicating, isn't it? It's just ceaseless medication. They're not stopping all that and saying, no, let's look, just look just at this. The difference between leaving different and abandoning. And there's no way to leave. You can only abandon. We can't leave God. We can only abandon God. At least attempt to abandon. Okay. But there's no leaving at all. You can't leave the peace of God. You can only abandon it. So just hear it. First you hear this and get used to hearing it. You may not be able to focus on it like I'm able to. And I need to focus on it better. I still have some work to do on this for sure. But now I see how crucial this is. How crucial. And that if we get used to seeing this clearly, and that's it. We will accept the peace of God along with our practicing, getting used to the wow practicing. But just accepting, wow, I accept the peace of God. Wow, I abandon the peace of God. Those are the only variables there can be. There can never be any leaving the peace of God. You can only abandon it. If we give up abandoning it, we have it. And the only way to not have it is to abandon it. So it's this examination, explanation, focus, attention, just this is a quantum leap that we need right now. Just this, not something else. Not even looking at the picture of Anandamayi Ma. Okay? This is better than that. And she'll be the first to tell you that. She told me that. She green-lighted this. She's, stop my picture. Stop all this. Stop all this stuff. She green-lighted it. I was waiting to see if she would green-light it, and she did. She green-lighted it. To look just at this. And say, wow. Looking at this, wow. Not looking at this, wow. Looking at this, wow. Abandoning and looking at this, wow. So, heaven, wow. Abandoning heaven, wow. Heaven, wow. Abandoning heaven, wow. Truth, wow. Abandoning truth, wow. Truth, wow. Abandoning truth, wow. That's the most potent type of practice you can actually practice. It's the strongest practice. So, you will find yourself doing this and then wanting to stop. That's fine. Stop consciously. Don't stop by thinking you've left the practice. You've abandoned the practice. Say, okay, I've abandoned the practice now. Okay? Practicing, wow. Abandoning practicing, wow. Practicing, wow. Abandoning practicing, wow. And then say, okay, I'll abandon it. For patience and non-action. So you abandon it for patience and non-action. Quantum leap, quantum leap, quantum leap. Quantum leap. And I will only focus on the quantum leap because I need to take a quantum leap too, you see. So I'm not going to focus on something else. I know this is it. So I'm not going to be focusing on something else. I have to save myself too. From hell, really. This quantum leap into a larger hell. That's the last thing we need. Hell, the vistas of hell suddenly expand and go even way further. I mean, is that good? It's like before we say, well, I got this small hell. And now suddenly we say, oh, I got this huge hell. Hell just goes on forever, you know. Is that what we really want? No, that's terrible. Then we become slavish slaves. Not just slaves, but slavish slaves. Being a slave is bad enough, but a slavish slave is even worse. And then being a dread-ridden slavish slave is even worse. And then being a chaos bedeviled, dread-ridden, slavish slave is the worst. And that's what the quantum leap of medication, that's what it's going towards. Ultimately, trying to apply chaos to shock the mind into conditions. It's like shock treatment for the mind, trying to shock the mind into being conditioned, having conditions. Doesn't work. That won't work. You will just simply find out it doesn't work. And then you say, oh my God, I'm a chaos, dread-ridden, slavish slave, and it doesn't work. I've already been there, so I know how it feels. But I also know how to walk it back to this quantum leap of practicing. I have the peace of God. Wow. I've abandoned the peace of God. Wow. I have the peace of God. Wow. I've abandoned the peace of God. I accept the peace of God. I abandon the peace of God. I accept the peace of God. I abandon the peace of God. I accept the peace of God. I abandon the peace of God. Wow. I accept the peace of God. Wow. I abandon the peace of God. Wow. I accept the peace of God. Wow. I abandon the peace of God. Wow. I accept the peace of God. Wow. I abandon the peace of God. Wow. I accept the peace of God. Wow. I abandon the peace of God. Wow. I accept the peace of God. Wow. I abandon the peace of God. Wow. I accept the peace of God. Wow. I abandon the peace of God. Wow. I accept the peace of God. Wow. I abandon the peace of God. Wow. I accept the peace of God. Wow. I abandon the peace of God. Wow. And then abandon the practice. I accept the practice. Wow. I abandon the practice. Wow. I accept the practice. Wow. I abandon the practice. Wow. And you could walk it back a little bit. I mean, not walk it. You can dilute your practicing as a way of kind of working with the burn too. That's possible. Good. Wow. Bad. Wow. Good. Wow. Bad. Wow. Good. Wow. Bad. Wow. Good. Wow. Bad. Wow. But at some point you might need to just abandon your practicing and right, like that. Oh, patience and non-action. Patience and non-action. So taking a quantum leap, it feels like a quantum leap, doesn't it? Yeah. It's like, this is, we're not in Kansas anymore. We've been caught up in a whirlwind of practice, effective practice, and a quantum leap here. Well, I lost a pound, but I still got like 3 more pounds to lose. So, you know, 3 more days of starvation ahead of me. That's crazy. I starve, I lose 3 pounds. I eat, I gain 3 pounds. Problem is, if I keep eating, I keep gaining weight. So, it's very difficult for me, this thing. But, of course, all eating is self-medication, but we don't want to... We want the peace of God, okay? And in the peace of God, somehow the body is sustained in a way where whatever you eat or don't eat, it's fine. Eating and not eating is all the same, basically. And under my mom, she would eat or not eat. It was all the same to her. She says, you want me to eat? Okay, I'll eat. You don't want me to eat? Okay, I won't eat. But not eating didn't have any effect on her, really. If she ate a lot, she could gain weight, or she could not. But if people, you know, if she ate a lot and she didn't gain weight, people got nervous, so she'd gain weight. But she could just eat continuously, massive quantities, and wouldn't gain any weight at all. Or she could eat a grain of rice a day and wouldn't lose any weight. Simple. Peace of God. But or you could just eat a normal amount and not gain weight either, or gain weight either way. It's hard to explain, isn't it? Because you're not medicating in any way except the peace of God. And the peace of God smooths everything out. Everything's already smoothed out. No side effects. No side effects. No matter what, everything feels, it's just, I don't need to medicate. I don't need to, you say, oh, flower, I don't need to medicate. Oh, tree, I don't need to medicate. Oh, So you stop seeing everything as means to medicate. It's already medicated. This flower, I'm already taking the flower medication. Tree, well, I'm already taking the tree medication, so I don't need to do it. I don't need to be redundant. So all redundancy is smoothed out, and you drop the redundancy. So you're no longer seeking that flower medication. You say, oh, I'm already taking that flower medication. I'm already taking the tree medication. I'm already without doing anything. It's already there. It's already there. So you drop all the redundancy. And you say, I don't need to think at all. That's redundant. I don't need to evaluate. It's redundant. So everything inherently in the now feels redundant. All evaluation is redundant. I'm already receiving perfect medication from the sky. I'm already receiving perfect medication from the sofa. I'm already receiving perfect medication from the light. I'm already receiving perfect medication from the flower. I'm already receiving perfect medication from the concrete. So you say, thank you. And you say, thank you for your perfect medication. It's worked perfectly. I don't feel any side effects. Oh, flower, thank you for your perfect medication. It's perfect. It's working perfectly. So everything's working perfectly. Wow. It's just like that. And you don't have to do anything at all. You're already receiving it. It's like the perfect miracle. It's the perfect medication. Okay. Plastic. Oh, I'm receiving perfect medication from you, plastic. Thank you so much. Person. Oh, thank you, person. I'm receiving perfect medication from your personality. Thank you very much. Tree. I'm receiving perfect medication from you, tree. It's working perfectly. Clouds. I'm receiving perfect medication from you, clouds. Thank you. It's working perfectly. Another person, I'm receiving perfect medication from you. It's working perfectly. Thank you. I'm receiving perfect medication from everything, and it's all working perfectly. And so attempting to think, evaluate, that is not necessary. It's redundant. It's completely redundant. Completely redundant. This is the quantum leap as the peace of God. It's already working perfectly. So I don't need to evaluate, is it working? I see everything I see is already working perfectly. So tree, thank you for your perfect medication. It's working perfectly. Breeze, thank you for your perfect medication. It's working perfectly. That's called bliss. Peace of God. Bliss, thank you for your perfect medication. It's already working perfectly. Sunshine, thank you for your perfect medication. It's already working perfectly. Rain, thank you for your perfect medication. It's already working perfectly. Heat, thank you for your perfect medication. It's already working perfectly. Coldness, thank you for your perfect medication. It's already working perfectly. Even before I saw you, coldness, it was working perfectly. Even before I saw you, daylight, it was already working perfectly. Even before I saw you, nighttime, it was already working perfectly. Stars, even before I saw you, stars, your perfect medication was already working perfectly. Space, even before I saw you, space, your perfect medication was already working perfectly. Planets, even before I saw you, planets, your perfect medication was already working perfectly. Sun, even before I saw you, sun, your perfect medication was already working perfectly. Plastic, even before I saw you, plastic, your perfect medication was working perfectly. Glass, even before I saw you, glass, your perfect medication was already working perfectly. Thank you for giving me your perfect medication. It was already working perfectly. There's no gap. It was already working perfectly. Amazing. So seeing you is like completely redundant. You'd already given to me. You've already given to me. Before I even saw you, you were already giving to me. So how you gave to me is imperceptible. Totally imperceptible. Totally immeasurable. It was already working. I can't explain how, because I can't perceive it, I can't measure it, I can't analyze it, I can't touch it, I can't sense it at all. But somehow, you were already giving it to me. Amazing. It was like instantaneous. It was so close to instantaneous that there's nothing I can even say about it, except gratitude. I just feel gratitude. But we won't say it's instantaneous, but it was so close to instantaneous, there's no gap at all. There's so close to instantaneous, there's no gap at all to even feel. I can't feel any gap there. That's how close it is. Yeah, plastic is everywhere, isn't it? Metal. Ah, oh, thank you, metal. Before I even saw you, metal, before my senses even saw you, your perfect medication, your medication was working perfectly. So my senses are too slow. It was even quicker than senses, you see. Your giving was received so quickly that the senses can't even recognize the quickness of it. So whatever I see, my senses, I realize I already have the medication from that. It's working perfectly. Wow, that's amazing. those leaves, my God, they're already giving me perfect medication. Even before I saw them, they were already doing it. Imaho, how wonderful! Wow, how wonderful! Pain, even before I saw you, pain, even before I felt you, pain, you were already giving me perfect medication, and it was working perfectly. Your medication was already working perfectly. Wow. Pleasure, even before I saw you, pleasure, your medication was already working perfectly. So those are two, that's two really, I just feel that's powerful. There's another very powerful one, pleasure and pain. Practice on that. Pleasure, before I even saw you, You were already giving me your perfect medication. Thank you. Pain, before I even saw you, you were already giving me your perfect medication. Before I even felt you, pleasure, you were already giving me your perfect medication. Pain, before I even felt you, you were already giving me your perfect medication. No side effects to any of it. Wow. It's working perfectly. That's powerful. See, our mind is not used to working in that way, is it? So you can feel like, wow. It's like a roller coaster ride. A thrill ride, like, wow. Not used to that. This is training the mind in a different way, right? We've been training it in a certain way. Now we're training it a different way. Mind training, really. Jesus said it could be called a course in mind training. A course in miracles could be called a course in mind training. Yeah, exactly. It is a course in mind training. And this here is a quantum course in mind training, actually. We've been able to simplify it down so we can take a quantum, we can go at quantum speed now. And the purpose of a course in miracles was to help us trend towards quantum practicing, quantum speed in practicing. And we have that here now. So we're doing it. We're doing it. Jesus said, forget about the Course in Miracles. None of my mind said, forget about me. Just practice in this quantum speed. That's what you need to do now. Just practice in this way. Now, it's difficult to sit still. I could, but I'm moving around a little bit now because the speed is so intense. It's so intense. But I'm still sitting, you know, I'm not getting up from my seat. But it's so intense. I'm going to shift off of a little bit and talk about something else. It's just this non-action and patience, non-action. I practiced yesterday. It was so intense. I was just like, blah, for the rest of the day. Just like, I felt okay, but I said, my God, this is so effective. You know, like, wow. I'm feeling that now. So God gave me a gift. It was really a great gift. I have not been watching the surfing. I stopped. God said stop, so I did. So I've the Drug Aware Margaret River Pro was the second stop on the tour, the championship tour of the World Surf League. I hadn't watched any of it. I haven't paid attention to it. I said, well, I'm sure it's over by now. So I checked to see who won. Who won? I want to know who won. I said, God said, yeah, you can check. So I checked. And then it said, date, final day. On call. I said, what? Final day. This is championship day. Finals day. I said, what? You mean it's not over? It wasn't over. And in fact, they hadn't even done the quarterfinals or the semifinals or the finals yet. So they had three rounds still to go. And it was the last day, so they had to do it. And they said, look, when does it start? And I said, well, it starts 7:05 Australian time. And it was like 5:30 Australian time. So an hour and a half was going to start. And I said, holy cow, maybe I can watch some of it. And I said, no, I don't want to do that. But God allowed me to watch it. Holy Spirit allowed me to watch it. And and lo and behold, there was a really beautiful swell in almost like perfect conditions. They've been on like hold for like 5 days, something like that, a long time. And the last day, perfect conditions, big swell, 8 to 10 feet overhead, powerful swell overhead, and glassy conditions, slight offshore breeze. Holy cow. And then it shifted to slight onshore breeze, and that smoothed it out even more. Because an offshore breeze pushes so that there's bands on the wave face, ripples, and it gets bandy on the wave face. Whereas a slight onshore breeze is blowing from the back of the wave. So it actually, the wave is much more glassy as you're on the face wave as you're surfing. It's much more glassy. So I got to watch the quarterfinals, which was 4 heats, the semis, which was 2 heats, and the final, which was 1 heat. And my guy was in the quarterfinals, John Florence. And it was Jack Anderson against Owen Wright in the first quarter. And Jack Anderson won because Owen Wright's fin came dislodged from his board on this, getting ready to do this awesome bottom turn. And one of his fins popped out and the board skidded and he fell and he got a no score. And then he had to go in and get a new board. By the time he came out, no more waves, the ocean went flat, and he lost the heat. It was unbelievable. Bad luck for him. So, the next heat was, I don't even remember exactly who was it. I know that the last heat was Felipe Toledo against Adrian D'Souza, and Felipe Toledo won that heat closely. The other one was Kolohe and Dino, something like that. Kolohe and Dino against Jordy Smith. And Kolohe and Dino got two insane barrels, two like 9 waves, and beat Jordy Smith. And the other one was John Florence against, who did he serve against? He obliterated him so bad, I don't even remember who he served against. That's amazing, isn't it? It'll come to me if I really focus on it. But anyway, Michael Borres. Yeah, Michael Borres. He's, I think that's his name, yeah. Didn't have a chance. I mean, John surfed so great. Just obliterated. I said, oh my God, was he on fire? And so then the semis was Jack Anderson against John Florence and Felipe Toledo against Chloe Andino. And John Florence just obliterated Jack Anderson. I mean, he just, again, was like surfing in another realm, at a different level. He could just, he was on another level. Whoever he surfed against, you could tell, obviously, he's on a completely different level. And then Chloe Andino beat Felipe Toledo, barely. And so these two guys went in the finals. John Florence against Chloe Andino, who's from the United States. John's from Hawaii, which is the United States too, but they think they're not. They think they're Hawaii. That's okay. And John just obliterated him. I mean, every heat he's putting up 2.9 pluses for his two waves. He gets like 19.27. He averaged like 19.27. for those last four heats or something. Last four, I think, was 19s. I think he had a high 18 in there, the average, which is insane. I mean, it's almost like perfect waves. He's almost going to get close to 210s. Every time he goes out, he gets close to perfect 210-point waves. He almost got a 10. Three judges gave him a 10 on one wave, and the others gave him like 9-something. 9.7s or something. It averaged out to like a 9.83. So he lays down like two waves that are almost perfect, and the other guy, you know, to beat that, he basically has to get two perfect waves, and, you know, there's not so many waves coming in to do that, and it's over. It's over. And the commentators were just going nuts. They're saying, well, first of all, they said it was the greatest competitive surfing in the history of surfing. That's what they all said. So I got to watch the greatest surfing in a competitive context that's ever happened. That's the gift God gave me. God said, you've been into surfing and stuff. Okay, I don't want you to watch any of it, except today I'll let you watch some of it because you practice so well. And I got to see the greatest competitive surfing in a context of a competitive competition, the greatest surfing in history that's ever happened. And that was John Florence. I told you this guy is great. And he just proved it. He gave everyone a treat. You know, I thank him. I was in tears. Everybody's like in tears. They were screaming or in tears. He never felt. I mean, it's just, you can't believe how he was surfing. I mean, one time he did this turn. It was a kind of a insane cutback carve turn. Where he did a layback turn, and he laid back so insanely, so far and into the white water that he actually came and sat down on his board. That's how far he had laid back. And yet he was still going down the face smoothly, and then he rose up to his feet again, all in one smooth maneuver. The whole thing was like one smooth maneuver. And just like someone said, that may be the greatest turn I've ever seen in my life. I mean, you had these commentators who were, both of them were world champions. They won the world championship. And they're saying, I said, I believe that is the greatest turn I've ever seen in my life. And then they said, wait a minute, I think maybe this is the greatest turn I've ever seen in my life. These are like super seasoned surfers, hardened guys, you know, saying, losing their minds. They saying, I've never seen anyone surf like this. We have never seen anyone surf like this before. The lines he is taking, we have never seen anyone do this before. So that's how great the surfing was. And he never lost it. He never fell. It was all fluid and smooth. And so this is the greatest surfing anyone's ever seen. In the context of a competition, you know, you can always say someone freestyled, but I don't know, we don't know, right? But when the pressure's on in a heat like that, you know, that really, to do it without falling ever, without ever a flaw, you know, it was like perfect surfing with lines on the wave that no one has ever seen before, okay? These guys said they've never seen surfing like this, and they've seen it all. They've seen it all. So God let me see this. I was like, wow, thank you, God. That what a treat. Thank you, John Florence. I mean, that was really a treat. It was a kind of medication, right? He said, you practiced peace of God, and now you know it was. You needed to cool out from it because you really pushed it. So we'll treat you with a little medication from a wave medication. John Florence wave medication. And it wasn't the peace of God, no. And it never will be. But it was something to behold. It was something to behold. And what a treat. I knew enough about, by watching the Snapper Rocks competition, which is the first competition I've ever seen, I gained enough knowledge about it all to be able to appreciate what I was seeing. And I understood how the heats work and everything. So I understood exactly what I was seeing. The jet skis bringing them out, everything, the whole thing. So I was able to just, the whole scenario, I was able to appreciate the entire thing, how it works. And John, he rode this wave in, and there's this reef in close to shore where the wave finishes up. It finishes up where you have to bank off the whitewater. But there's a channel there where it finishes up. But the channel, the whitewater, then takes you into this reef, which is rocky bottom that sticks up from the bottom. And the tide was low enough, so the reef became, it sucked the water out, and it was exposed. It was completely exposed, but here he is in the channel with the white water pushing him right towards this exposed reef. And for him, it's just a wall of rock. And he got slammed right into that wall of rock by this powerful white water. And everybody's going, oh my God. And he, you know, surfaced, but we said, uh-oh. He might have gotten injured. Well, he did. He smashed his elbow into the reef, and the barnacles and all cut his elbow really bad. And he was stunned by it. And he climbed up on the reef then. The white water pushed him up on it. And we were like, oh, it's kind of scary to even talk about. But it was bleeding and everything. And it's like, whoa, maybe he can't. But he continued. You know, he went out there. But he was trying to keep his elbow out of the water because not to attract sharks. And an interesting background to this, in the Kaloi Andino and I believe Jordy Smith. Yeah, it was Jordy Smith, Kaloi Andino, Jordy Smith heat semifinal. Was that semis? No, quarterfinal. Quarterfinal heat. No, sorry. It was the semifinal heat. Kaloi Andino against Felipe Toledo, and Kaloi Andino was losing that heat. And there was this huge school of salmon came in to shore. And you could see it. Like you could see in the face of the waves, that it became a little transparent. Oh, salmon, hundreds of salmon just everywhere. And all these jet skis, people went out on jet skis and were like monitoring this. And something was going on, and we said, well, folks, we got a dangerous situation. Why was it dangerous? Because right where the surfers were sitting, there was thousands of salmon, huge schools of salmon just going everywhere. They were coming in towards shore, but towards a river mouth. Because sharks follow the schools of salmon, picking them off. One, you know, picking and picking and picking and picking. That's what happens. Sharks are predators. They follow schools of fish. And of course, there were sharks following the school of salmon. And this makes it very dangerous for the surfers. Now, they had this shark shield technology. I don't know if they had it on the bottom of the boards. They can put it on the bottom of boards. It's electronic shield. So they had that in place. But they deemed it way too dangerous for the surfers. And so they were called out of the water because of shark danger of sharks. So then the fish went on down the coastline. And they said, okay, it's safe now because the sharks will be following the fish. So they went back out, and then Colayandino won the heat, made a comeback in the heat and won. But then John Florence is out there in the ocean, and he cuts his elbow, and it's bleeding, which means blood will be dripping into the ocean. That's a dangerous situation, too. So he's holding his elbow up while he's out there and making sure the blood runs down his arm and not dripping into the ocean. Okay, they're aware of this. I mean, sharks. Jordy Smith got attacked in South Africa last year by a shark. Attacked. It was really scary. He could have been killed. No, was it Jordy Smith? Oh, no, it was Mick Fanning. No, sorry, it was Mick Fanning. I believe it was Mick Fanning got attacked by a shark, a great white shark, in Jeffreys Bay in South Africa last year. Yeah, it was Mick Fanning. Jordy Smith, some from South Africa. That's why I thought about that. So he's out there and he's in the heat, trying to win this semifinal heat with his elbow all cut up badly, and it's bleeding. But he says, "No, I'm going to keep going." And he proceeded to rip off two like 9.8s. You know, it's like what? Or maybe one more. Maybe the one he cut his elbow on was a 9.82. But he proceeded to continue to surf. And afterwards, they interviewed me. They said, well, my legs weren't hurt, so it wasn't hurting my surfing, really. It didn't faze him at all. But he said, yeah, I mean, it hurt. It hurt. But the adrenaline was pumping. So probably hurts today. Bell's contest starts in a couple of days in Eastern Australia. So I don't know how you feel then. But so that was really quite a drama. It was just like the greatest contest ever, they're saying. One of those. But the greatest surfing ever in a contest. Through all the heats, through the first round, then the third round, and then the quarters. Because he won the first round, so you skip the second. You go automatically in the third round. Then he won the third round. So then you go into the fourth round. But if you lose the fourth round, then you have to do a fifth round. So he goes first round, third round, fourth round. He won those, so now he's in the quarters. So then he's got the quarters, semis, finals. So there's first round, second round, fourth round, quarter, final, semi, and finals. I think it's six rounds that he surfed. So if you win every round, you have to surf six rounds to win the finals. Theoretically, you could surf eight rounds. If you lose the first round, you go into a second round, and if you win that, then you go into the third, and if you win the third, you go into the fourth. But if you win the lose the fourth, you go into a fifth round, and if you win the fifth round, then you go into the quarterfinals with the ones who won the fourth round. So you could theoretically have to surf eight rounds. You could win by surfing eight rounds. That's possible. But the easiest way is to do it by winning six rounds. Which is what he did. He never lost a heat in no way the way he was surfing. And everyone said from the beginning, he says, might as well just give him the trophy right now. You know, he's unbeatable. He's unbeatable. That's pretty amazing. It's like an inevitability. You just felt it was, they said, it was absolutely inevitable. Nobody is surfing can surf the waves like he was surfing. They said, it's the best these waves have ever been surfed. Nobody has ever surfed that Margaret River waves as good as John Florence surfed him. No one has ever done it. It was a completely different level of surfing. How do you do that? How do you just do a different, higher level of surfing? But it was traditional surfing. He didn't do a single aerial, not a single aerial. It was all just carving the face of these waves. He was doing it with more speed, okay, and different lines than anybody had ever done. He was using a small board. His board, he said, was perfect. It was shaped absolutely perfect. He said it was just, man, you could do no wrong on that board. But by design, They had served it by design. They designed it just right for his weight, for how he surfs, for that type of wave. Everything was perfect. And he just couldn't miss. You just say, oh my God, he's going to fall for sure. Are you kidding me? He's upside down. He's hitting his turn so hard, he's up literally upside down. And then on his side like this, and the rail is completely in the water except like a little area by the nose. He sinks his rails in it so far, and it's just on the rails like that. And you just say, oh my God, it's like snowboarding. They say it's like snowboarding, the wave. But he never fell. Like a cat, he just wouldn't fall. Awesome. It's the best he's ever surfed. He said, is this the best? You're probably on the top form. He says, yeah, I think so. I'm at a new level as far as my surfing goes. So I got to see that. How amazing. I quit surfing for 40 years. I didn't surf for 40 years. And then here I come back to pay attention to surfing again after 40 years, and I get to see this best surfing in history. How amazing is that? It's like I didn't miss anything. I don't regret it. There's no regrets. This kind of swept the regrets away from me. That's why how peace of God sweeps all regrets away from you. Because you have like the perfect medication. Where now everything is already giving you the perfect medication. This flower is giving me perfect flower medication. This tree is already giving me perfect tree medication. So all the regrets of whatever you have, gone. Gone. So all the regrets I had of not paying attention to surfing for all these years, it's like seeing that perfect surfing is just like, it's okay, I don't care. I just got to see the most awesome surfing ever. On those waves. Now those waves, I mean, I could ride those waves. I mean, those waves were rideable. They said they were very powerful and tricky and difficult, but he made it look easy. I said, oh, I can do that, that's easy. But the rest of the guys were saying, my God, these waves are difficult. They're so tricky. It's so difficult to ride these. But I had no difficulty whatsoever. I didn't see any difficulties. Like, walk in the park. It was enjoyable. And he said, oh, this is fun. Yeah, I had a lot of fun out there, man. I just loved it. But he said this, I think he said this is the most fun he's ever had riding waves. It was so fun. I can't believe how fun that was for me. And he loved that wave. He loved the wave. He said, I can't wait to get back here. This was so much fun. The rest of the guys are shaking their head. And now they're saying, who can beat him? I mean, he's unbeatable right now. He's unbeatable. I mean, they go to different breaks. So different breaks, you have to surf differently. So, of course, he's not going to win every single time. But you feel that way. You feel that he's at a different level. And he is. He is. He's clearly the best surfer in the world right now, with apologies to Kelly Slater, who is still the greatest surfer of all time. But I don't know. It's a toss up. I mean, Kelly can still throw a variety of moves that are just unbelievably great. Kelly Slater beat him in Chapu in Tahiti last year in the finals. And people said that was the greatest heat of all time. There's never been a greater heat. It was John Florence against Kelly Slater. And they were just throwing up, the most insane surfing that's ever been seen on that heat. In that wave, which is a totally different type of wave. It's like barrel riding. So they're close. They're but Kelly Slater won. Because he did some stuff that was just amazing. Utterly amazing. How he got under the lip. But So they're very close, but John has gotten better now. And so John is now maybe inching ahead of Kelly Slater. It's a dynamic. We'll see. Maybe by the end of this year, he'll be even better than Kelly Slater. But, Kelly Slater will have something to say about that. But he is, again, trending towards being the greatest surfer ever. And the surfer said that You know, even Kelly Slater has never done cutbacks, turns like that. They're more powerful with more speed and more radical, and the smoothness of it all, it's new territory. We've never seen surfing like this before. That's what they say, so I'll take their word for it. These are guys that have seen Kelly Slater his whole career, and they're saying that. They're saying, we've never seen surfing like this before. So, I don't know. I hadn't seen Kelly Slater at all until just recently, the first contest. I looked at video and stuff, but seeing him live is a different story. I've watched some video of him, and so I see what he does. And, he's a genius, surfing genius. But it seems like John Florence has brought something new to the table, where the skateboard, snowboarding influence, and then the shaping of boards is getting more and more genius-like, and how to get it tweaked just right. He seems to have just an extra edge to his surfing that we haven't seen before. It's at a higher level. They call it next level surfing. He's the next level surfer. How about this for a surf rundown, right? You think I know it all. I don't, but I kind of get it, don't I? I kind of get it. And they say even when he makes mistakes, it doesn't even look like he's making mistakes. Or even when he seems to lose a little balance, it doesn't look that way. His recovery is so quick, and his power and speed is so great, and the lines he's taking are so great, it all continues to look like fluid and beautiful. Because I could see a little there, but he smoothed it out in such a way that, you know, it didn't affect anything. And so the judges don't even judge him down for that. You know, that's how good he is. Oh, he got tubed at Margaret River. This huge barrel, and he's disappeared, completely disappeared. And they said, is he going to make it out or not? And it's sectioned out on him. And they said, well, he's going to have to go through the curtain, they call it. When you're in a tube and it sections out, you have to punch through that curtain of white water. And he said, is he going to make it out? Well, of course Superman comes out. Just flying, he came flying out of the curtain, proceeded to do this massive carve off the face of the wave, off coming out of the curtain, like it was all just, you know, all just meant to be. Like, what? Of course he's gonna punch out of the curtain. I mean, who could doubt it? But they were thinking, well, I don't know if he's gonna even come out of this. I mean, it's gonna be pretty amazing if he comes out. But he came out like nothing, of course, like smoothly. He just came out smoothly, like it's no big deal. Just still right in the flow of the wave. Come on, man. That is it's amazing. Very cool. What a show he put on. What a show. And it's a little better than other sports because it's so unpredictable, waves. It's like, you know, like Tony Hawk on a vert ramp or half pipe or something. The half pipe is just there. It's the same. So, you know, it's like, yeah, he's doing these aerials, and yeah, but the ocean is different. The conditions are constantly unpredictable there. There's so many unpredictable variables you're dealing with. So to make it all the way it looked smooth, the way he did, is, I think, that the highest kind of athletic accomplishment, actually. Because most other athletics, the playing field is kind of stable, right? Basketball, the rim, the court, and everything. It's like playing basketball on a court, an ocean that's constantly shifting and changing and moving, and I mean, holy cow. The playing field isn't level. I mean, it's unpredictable. And to make it seem, he makes it look predictable. He makes the ocean seem predictable. And they said something about the wave, how he makes the wave look different, like it's predictable. Like a wave pool or something. He makes this unpredictableness look like it's predictable. And so that's next level surfing. It's tweaking everybody's minds, actually. It really is. These are, again, 30-year pros, championship surfers, and it's tweaking their minds. He's tweaking their minds, their expectations. He said, there's a next level. He's making it all this look like easy, fun, predictable, like a wave pool. And he said, folks, I guarantee you, it is not a wave pool out there. This is really rough, difficult, tough, bully surf out there. And the guys are coming in, they're saying it. They said, man, those waves, it's deep ocean surfing. These waves are powerful and very difficult and tricky. But you watch him, no, it's like a wave pool. And they say, what's wrong with these other guys? Why are they struggling? What's the matter with them? I don't know how he... And it's the speed he's maintaining. He's able to get speed and maintain it. Say, how is he maintaining speed like that? And so when you're speeding through the wave, it looks easy. And you're not getting caught up in the whitewater and the sections and even the bumpiness he cuts through it, the way his rail work is. He's just carving it up like it's easy. But the rest of the guys, no way. They're bouncing around. They're getting caught by the white water. They're struggling to get through the section here. They're trying to do this. It looks tough for them. It looks difficult for them. And these are the best surfers in the world. And they're coming in and say, wow, it's really difficult out there. But for Florence, it doesn't look difficult at all. It looks just like super easy. Like he's just out there having fun. And that's what he says. I'm just having fun. That's a lot of fun. Well, yeah, John, what about the difficulty? No, I don't know. For me, it was just fun. You don't hear him say it was difficult. He said, well, that was a lot of fun. It was kind of like Michael Jordan watching him when he was at his heyday playing basketball. He's unstoppable. And for him, it looked like it was easy. He was just having fun out there. Like I said, what's the matter with these other basketball players? How come they're not having fun like that? It's not difficult at all. It's easy. Jordan has come up the court, and you say, oh, he's going to have fun now. You can see in his eyes. This is fun. What am I going to do on this move? Juke this way, and then, sail this way, and go fly, and then slam it like that, reverse slam, one-hand slam, whatever. It's just fun. I'm just out here having fun. He'd go down the court, kind of his tongue wagging, like, hey, that was fun. And the rest of the guys are just grinding, struggling, sweating, grinding. He's like, God, this is so difficult. Ah, upset and frustrated. Not Jordan. He's saying, man, this is a blast, I wish I could play two games today. Man, I don't want to quit. Come on, guys. Let's play. Let's have some more fun. So Florence is like that. Except it's in this arena of unpredictability. Now, sure, you got players trying to stop you, but they're predictable to a certain extent in terms. The ocean is a different story. It's kind of like the ultimate in unpredictability. And so you don't know what they say that they marveled at how he is able to assess the wave and his maneuvers on the fly so quickly, so it just looks like fun and ease. And they say, boy, how's he doing that? He always has the right maneuver for the wave. The right maneuver at the right instant to just cut up that wave and make it look like it's some little puny beach break or something, like Waikiki. He's like, he made Margaret River look like Waikiki, the way he was surfing those waves. It's the opposite of that. It's one of the toughest waves in the world when it's pumping like that. So in our practicing here, we're making this is like the toughest practice there is. We're making it look pretty easy. But we need to take some breaks from it, because the shock of the ease of it, because we've told ourselves this lie for so long that there's no way, that this whole thing is super difficult. And if there's some way to get free of it, it's incredibly difficult. It's some super complex medical compound or something. It's going to take like all, a universe full of computers computing for a trillion years to come up with this compound that's going to actually medicate us properly. And so the fact that we're able to, one, recognize that the peace of God does it all for us, and that we don't have to do anything, it's already given to us, and that it's easy to get to it. All we have to do is this practice, simple practice, and that will get us to it. This is very shocking to us. It's like if you were taking like a beginning surfer, thinking like, I'll never be able to surf like very great like John Flores, and then have them out there surfing like John Flores. Oh, it's easy, you know. Like seeing these waves, these really gnarly waves, saying, oh my God, I'd never be able to surf these waves well. And then within a matter of very short time, be out there carving them up like John Florence. You know, that would be pretty shocking. Pretty shocking. Very shocking, actually. It's funny that Chloe Andino, the man in the finals, he was right here in San Francisco surfing with, I think it was Nat Young or Nat Taylor or something, or Ocean Beach. I saw a video of him surfing Ocean Beach. I was watching Ocean Beach, the waves. They were those kind of waves they're surfing. And let me tell you, those aren't easy waves to surf. But they were like, they're so good, they were able to surf them. A lot of other guys couldn't surf them. They were so tough. So they were spent a lot of time this winter surfing Northern California. And that's why he could do those tube rides, because those kind of waves, you're going to get tubed. Really fast waves. And yet he could not carve up Margaret River. He was able to do a couple of good tube rides, but as far as carving like John, no way, no way. So John, for sure, he could carve up Ocean Beach, just carve it up. Like nobody else. That would be great to see. Maybe someday he'll, you know, do some free surfing at Ocean Beach, but of course nobody would know about it. So don't hold your breath unless he tells you, hey, I'm coming to Ocean Beach. But that would draw a crowd to see him surf Ocean Beach when it's big, because those waves are so, so fast and powerful. And it gets big there. That'd be really great to watch. But in my mind, I can see how he could do it. I could see how I could do it. It's certainly possible. At that level, at that next level, it's certainly possible. And if you can do it, it's easy. You see, if you can't do it, it's brutal. Just think of that, a really powerful wave. If you can surf it, that was fun. Doesn't touch you. If you can't do it, it's going to bully you and torment you and beat you up and just pound you. I mean, you'll be bumping around and barely make it, and it'll scare the heck out of you, and then finally you won't make it and it'll crush you, and so and that's not fun. It's the opposite of fun. But here with this practice, it's fun. It's like we're surfing the waves, it's not even touching us. We keep catching these waves, getting barreled, coming out. This is great. This is what this practice is like. Whereas if you don't do this practice, you'll try to be surfing the waves, and it's going to be scary, really scary, and then you're going to eat it, and you're going to get just crushed, and you'll come up and you'll be dazed and confused, and you're saying, wow, can I have another? I don't know. Go out, same thing happens, and after it happens about 10 times, you're going to go into the beach, and you're just going to lie down and saying, you know what, I think I'm going to quit surfing for a while, right? You will say that. I've been there and done that, and said, this is just not for me. This is not for me. Whereas if you ride, you know, 20 waves just beautifully and have fun, you come in and say, my God, that was fun. I can't wait to get out and do it again tomorrow. Same waves, but one, you have the skill, and the other one doesn't have enough skill. The difference may be the board, okay? The difference may be the board. You're riding the wrong board for that place, and it's floating too high. You can't get the rails in. You can't get enough speed. You can't, the turns, you're up too high on the turns. You can't dig into the turns properly, et cetera, et cetera. It's not going to work for you. But if you have just the right board for the wave, you're going to make everything, and it'll be like, oh, this is easy, this is fun. So the board here is the practice. We have the right practice designed exactly for the peace of God, for the wave, the peace of God. Exactly the right board. And so we're riding the wave, say, woo, that was fun. That's how I feel. I'm not getting crushed anymore. You know, I finally know how to surf the waves like John Florence. So I know how to surf the practice waves like John Florence. The inner waves, the mental waves, the practice waves, yeah. It's like a wave pool. Except it's being done in the ocean of samsara, ocean of hope and fear. There's no more ferocious ocean than that. Sometimes you might get banged up a little bit, but like John, you banged up your elbow. I said, well, I can still get out there. I can still stand up and surf, so I'm going to keep doing it. But if the sharks come, you know, you get out of the ocean for a little while. Get out of the ocean. If there's a lot of, you know, if there's sharks, you get out of the ocean. So, like, Facebook was like a school of fish. What really, it's like all these fish. It's a perfect analogy. All these fish, so many fish are suddenly come in and, like, reacting. And then suddenly, these sharks started showing up. I got befriended by some sharks. And I checked them out and said, holy cow, these are psychopaths. These are predators. Really. There's some real predators that showed up, wanted to friend me. They're following the fish of Facebook. Said, oh, here's another fish. Maybe I can eat him. Yeah. There were sharks that showed up. And I was aware of it. I said, uh-oh. And I said, I think I'm going to get out of the water here. Okay. Because there may be some even worse sharks show up after them. There's some sharks showing up. And I said, this isn't good. And then behind them, maybe some really hungry heavyweight sharks. I said, I'm getting out of the water right now. Boom, got out of the water. And let me tell you, on Facebook, there are sharks stalking you. Believe me. There are a lot of psychopaths on Facebook. A lot. And we know that. On the internet, there's a lot of psychopaths. But on Facebook, they have a way of really stalking you. Really stalking you. That's why people don't like putting up the information of where they live. You know, nothing stuff can identify where they live. Because these psychopaths will stalk you. We know that. All sorts of stuff. And so, you're on Facebook, you're getting stalked. And you have to keep, you know, blocking. But then this paranoia sets in. That's no good. You know, I don't want that to set in. I say where I lived, you know, I put all public information. I don't want to live in fear. You don't want to live in fear. And nobody can hurt you if you don't allow them to. But they try to trick you into agreeing to it. That's what a psychopath does. They try to trick you into it. So, when they're stalking you, it's better just to stay away from them. Because you start feeling nervous and a little bit frightened. Because you say, well, I'm okay, but I sort of feel like also endangered a bit. Because they're really clever at tricking you into deciding you want to medicate yourself in this way of, you know, harming yourself in some way, harming the body or attacking yourself. It's just medication. What they try to tell you is like, hey, try this medication, you know. I think this will work for you. And they trick you, you kind of confuse you to doing that. So when I saw, there's a lot, there were quite a few, and I could tell that they were quite expert psychopaths. And so, but not as expert, and not top, you know, top drawer, and not the worst. It was trending. The trend was towards worse and worse and worse. So I saw the trend. I said, got to stop it right now before you attract a really practiced psychopath, because that's not good for anyone. Not even for me. You got to be humble enough to say, hey, you know, stay away from that. So I got away from the school of fish. No more sharks. I'm able to practice tremendously better now. I'm practicing way, way better now than when I was on Facebook. Way better. Less fear. So, you may need to get out of the water of Facebook, all right, at some point. You may need to just get out of that water for a while. You can go back later on if you want to. I mean, the surface went back once all the fish had cleared out. But for a while, you may want to get out of the water for a while. Now, if I went onto Facebook advocating that everybody leave it, they'd probably shut my account down. I mean, they're kind of picky, aren't they? Very picky. They're very autocratic, Facebook. So I don't think they want people on their a Facebook page advocating that everybody quit Facebook. We should do that. But I'm pretty sure they would. I mean, they shut a lot of pages down on Facebook, and that one would be number one. They would shut that down. Of course they would. They're in the business of selling your information to third parties without your permission, really. They claim your agreement, you gave them permission, but I mean, realistically, that should not stand in court. I mean, if you put enough fine print and say, and then tempt something with people, something very tempting, and then later on say, well, it was in the fine print, you just didn't read it, that's, you would say that's unjust inducement. You know, from a legal standpoint, you'd say, no, you cannot expect everybody that goes on Facebook to read all the fine print and understand exactly what it's saying, exactly what you're doing. Otherwise, you can't join Facebook. That's a totally unreasonable expectation you're putting out there. Legally unsound, very much so. A wise panel of judges would side with Facebook users saying, you can't have that expectation. One in a million is going to read it all and truly understand what it's all about. And the rest, you know, you're inducing them so severely. It's unreasonable expectation. It's like tobacco companies, you know, the people are not going to find for the tobacco company all the advertising, all the inducements they did. And you can't expect everybody to know exactly all the harmful effects of tobacco, and you know, right? So they sided with the people who spoke. The tobacco company said, well, they took the risk, come on. So from a legal standpoint, you know, we have to realize that this issue, you can't expect everybody to read the fine print, but they will certainly invoke that. They say, well, that's against fair use of our platform here. It's against the rules of our usage of our platform. They have rules, and you've broken some of the rules, and you have to understand you can't do that. But we could claim higher rules than that. So we'd say, well, you are breaking a higher law, okay, which is fair use, right use, spiritual use of that website. So you don't have a right to, because you didn't read fine print was right in bold letters. You did not read our bold letters of us using the site. You have to agree to our spiritual rules, you see, which is we have a right to direct people in the right direction to their salvation, and we have the right to use, since you are a public entity here, we have a right to use what you're offering in the public marketplace to turn people towards salvation. That's a higher law, and so you are disobeying that higher rule. You see how that works? And they said, well, we don't know about that. Well, you claim that ignorance of your bylaw rules are no excuse. Well, we can claim the same for ours, except we didn't put ours in fine print. It was in bold print. Fair use for purpose of salvation. That's like the rule. So you just simply were willfully ignorant of it. They're not going to get the judgment from me for themselves. Not in my courtroom, they're not. A lot of people leave Facebook because of these issues. You know, there's just every manner of derelict, you know, coming at you from so many angles. Along with those who refuse to practice. So there's a little bit of trending there, you know, but again, at this time in history, we need quantum practice. We need to go to quantum speed. And Facebook is not fast enough, and the habits are not good at all, of jumping around too much. So leave Facebook for a while. Get out of the water for a while. because there's too many sharks there. Too many sharks there. Wow. It's. And if you start blocking people, you feel guilty about that, right? So it's better just to back off the whole thing. Go to YouTube instead. Watch YouTube videos. I think YouTube would be happy for that. Say, yeah, this guy's saying, use YouTube. We like that. It's a better platform because you can have these videos that are way more powerful, really, even though you can post videos on Facebook. Of course, YouTube might not like it because people post videos on there, and then Facebook users watch their videos. So it's all insidiously, you know, intertwined, isn't it, technology? At some point, they will say, you can't advocate anyone not use some technology because they're all intertwined. So I can't say on YouTube not to use Facebook. Say, no, that hurts our revenue stream too. So you have to advocate. You cannot be an advocate for getting out of the water, even though it's full of sharks. Pretty amazing, huh? So you better do it while you can, while it's not too late right now. So if I went back to Facebook, I would advocate this, but how to do it without getting banned, you know? That's an interesting question. I'd say, folks, I highly advocate, this is all I'm advocating, watch these videos, that's it. And then in the videos, I'll tell you, get out of Facebook. But they may say, well, you're posting videos on Facebook telling you to leave Facebook. So that's against our rules, right? Yeah, of course they would say that. A little warmer today here in California. The sun is out. It's after the storm. Après storm. And so there's a little bit of warmth coming back in, which is good, but it's still chilly. I woke up this morning and I felt like weird because I felt the atmosphere, just a vibe. It's like, this is really rare. I can hardly place it. This is so odd. It feels like autumn, but it's spring. It feels like autumn in spring. So strange. So I said, this is weird. It was really a like cold autumn storm, or like brought hail to San Jose, a lot of hail on April 8th. Massive snow to the Sierra in April. So, and the winds, the ferocity of the winds in April, I mean, the whole thing was just really, really weird. It just, I can't tell if I'm in November or, you know, or April. I mean, and of course, the angle of the sun is similar to autumn right now, right? So it you feel like maybe it's autumn. I can feel that right now. Maybe it's autumn. That's really weird. It's really wowish, you might say. That's a big wow. Very rare to feel that way. A little disconcerting. We're so used to the seasons and being, you know, in sync with it. To suddenly feel out of sync with the seasons is an unusual feeling. But maybe we could practice something like that. Like, it's December. Wow. It's August. Wow. It's January. Wow. It's November. Wow. It's March. It feels like March. Wow. It feels like November. Wow. It feels like June. Wow. It feels like December. Wow. It feels like September. Wow. It feels like May. Wow. It feels like October. Wow. It feels like February. Wow. It feels like July. Wow. Try that. That's an interesting practice. That may be a powerful practice too. Oh, well, it feels like December. Wow. It feels like August. Wow. This feels like March. Wow. Maybe this is a very helpful practice, because the peace of God, everything, just, this feels like the peace of God. We'll say like, December feels like the peace of God. Wow. August feels like the peace of God. Wow. March feels like the peace of God. Wow. October feels like the peace of God. Wow. January feels like the peace of God. Wow. July feels like the peace of God. Wow. May feels like the peace of God. Wow. November feels like the peace of God. Wow. March feels like the peace of God. Wow. September feels like the peace of God. Wow. April feels like the peace of God. Wow. This flower feels like the peace of God. Wow. December is already giving me its perfect medication. Wow. I'm getting perfect medication. We're already getting perfect medication from September. Wow. I'm already getting perfect medication from January. Wow. I'm already getting perfect medication from March. Wow. I'm already getting perfect medication from September. Wow. I'm already getting perfect medication from June. Wow. I'm already getting perfect medication from November. Wow. I'm already getting perfect medication from April. Wow. I'm already getting perfect medication from September. Wow. I'm already getting perfect medication from February. Wow. I'm already getting perfect medication from August. Wow. That's a very profound quantum speed practice. So not only am I already getting perfect medication from everything in April, I'm also getting perfect medication from everything in December. So that's kind of knocking out time-space, doesn't it? Like, that's saying time-space is already giving me perfect medication. Wow. Process is already giving me perfect medication. Wow. Form is already giving me perfect medication. Wow. You say, all time-space is already giving me perfect medication. Wow. All process is already giving me perfect medication. Wow. All form is already giving me perfect medication. Wow. So this is generalizing, and then we can break it down into the months for that time-space type of thing. The seasons. October is already giving me its perfect medication. Wow. Perfect October medication right now. Wow. Perfect December medication for me right now. Wow. In other words, all attempts at medication have already been perfected, and you're already receiving them. It's all perfect. It's all perfect medication, meaning all insecurities have vanished. Even the insecurities of regret have vanished. So there's no time that I can think of that I'm not getting perfect medication from. And time we think of as the cycles of the seasons, right? And the cycles of a year, we can do it with the years. Wow. I'm already getting perfect 40-year medication. Wow. I'm already getting perfect 90-year-old medication. Wow. I'm already getting perfect 1-year-old medication. Wow. I'm already getting perfect 70-year-old medication. Wow. I'm already getting perfect 20-year-old medication. Wow. I'm already getting perfect 50-year-old medication. Wow. I'm already getting perfect 10-year-old medication. Wow. I'm already getting perfect 30-year-old medication. Wow. I'm already getting perfect 60-year-old medication. Wow. I'm already getting perfect 100-year-old medication. Wow. I'm already getting perfect 1,000-year-old medication. Wow. I'm already getting a perfect 1-day-old medication. Wow. How about that? Use it with age. This practice with age. Wow. Talk about ringing your bell. Talk about quantum practice. And again, if Sri Sri Anandamaya Ma green lights it, which she did, it's a go. It's a go. It's go time. So first we used it with things. Then we used it with the seasons. And then we used it with lifespan, aging. And you could even say, but let me give it a break here. Don't let me launch in. This is a very profound. Let this sink in for right now. So we have age practice, we have season practice, we have thing practice, or circumstance practice. We can say things, flowers, trees, bushes, shrubs, sky, we see it as objects. I use the term things, but some people use the term objects. I never think of terms of stuff being objects. I never thought that way, really. I never thought of myself as a subject and stuff as and other stuff as objects. So it's hard for me to speak that way. But things, yeah, that thing over there, sort of, yeah. You can use it that way, but just practice. This flower, that post. Wow, that post is giving me perfect post-medication. Already, that post, wow. That post is already giving me perfect post-medication. Wow. That post is already giving me perfect post-medication. Wow. This flower is already giving me perfect flower medication. Wow. That tire is already giving me perfect tire medication. Wow. It's perfect tire medication. Wow. That tree is already giving me its perfect tree medication. Wow. So form, you could have form practice, and age practice, that's process, and then season practice, like time-space practice. So we have a time-space practice with seasons, a process practice with aging, and a form practice with things. And then we have a opposite good and bad practice for duality, okay? For hope and fear, hope and fear practice. So there you go. We got our golf clubs in the bag. It's in the bag. Ready to go play golf. Can I play golf? My knee, I could still play golf. Even if I'm limping, I could still swing the club for some reason. No, I'd rather be practicing like this. Now, because I'm practicing like this and helping people with this quantum speed practice, the wow practice is really quantum speed practice. Maybe God will give me, let me go play golf occasionally. He said, you know what? We need to take a break. Go play some golf. I might do it. Just like I watched John, maybe he'll say, hey, Tiger Woods, go watch Tiger Woods play golf. Now, if he could use a cart, maybe he'd be okay, because it's walking, it hurts him. Walking hurts his knees, and his back gets hurt. But who would I go watch? I don't know who. Maybe watch myself play golf. Maybe I'm hitting it as good as Tiger right now. I don't know. I don't know, because I'm not hitting it at all. Well, if neither one of us are hitting it, then we're probably both hitting it just as good right now. But yeah, I might be hitting it good. I might go out there and hit it really good, which would be fun. Carve up the golf course, make it look easy. That's what I want to do. I want to make it look easy. I don't want to go out there and struggle, get beat up. No way. So I don't even want to play until I feel like I can just make it look easy. That's it. Not interested. If God says you're ready, then I'll say okay. But until then, you know, until it's green lighted, you know, no. That might happen. It could. I don't put anything past God. God might say, you know what? You got it going now. You got the practices going now. So you know what to do. You know what to practice. So I know you're going to be practicing steadily now and be successful. So I'm going to put you in a place where you can play golf on a daily basis as a break from the practicing. Because this kind of practice really requires some sort of break after you do it. Just like yesterday, I really needed to just let it settle in. Let it settle in. It's that powerful. But I'm not going to go out in some municipal golf course dodging golf balls, a bunch of drunkards and yahoos and, you know, forget it. No way. Let it settle in a peaceful way. So I want to be in a really beautiful, peaceful place to let the practice, this quantum speed wow practice, settle in. I'm not going to put myself in some really hectic place. Yesterday I was just there with headphones on or in front of a computer in a dark room just watching the surf contest. It was beautiful with some water, some snacks. I mean, a kale smoothie. I had a kale smoothie there. And it was awesome. What an experience that was. And thanks WSL for streaming it live for free. You know, that's awesome. And the commentators, everybody involved, you know, that was, you know, great show. I mean, you put on a tremendous event. And I imagine more people are going to be watching that with John Florence is surfing. I mean, I don't know how you don't watch that guy, you know, really. Good grief. As they said, every time he stands up on a wave, you're going to see, you don't know what to expect. You're going to see something you never saw before. How's my knee? Not too bad today. There's still soreness in there somewhere. I don't know how you get the soreness out, but yeah, you don't know. Be nice to do, like, you know, like a 5-hour practice or 3-hour, however long, and that's very intense, maybe 5-hour, and then play golf. You know, that would be a good day. I'm willing to do that. 5-hour practice for the world. Give the world a 5-hour practice session. And but that's enough. And then play golf for 5 hours or something. Right? Because you've got to take a break. You've got to take a break and let it sink in. You don't want to be doing it 10 hours at this point. It's too powerful for that. You could do it 10 hours if you took breaks in between. But even then, you reach a point where it's like, okay, got to let it sink in. It's enough. So what do you do then? What do you do? You got to be careful what you do. Got to be in a peaceful setting, calm, peaceful setting. Don't try to do too much. Be kind of passive. Golf's pretty passive. I mean, you ride in a golf cart, just ride around a golf cart. If it's summertime there, I'll just go on a golf course and ride around on the golf course for like 5 hours. I don't even have to hit the ball, you know, but I probably would. I'd probably go out and hit it, but there's nobody out when it's real hot. So that's perfect. And just go out in the afternoon or something. And, I don't know, ride around for 5 hours and come in. Just so peaceful. It's super hot. Just the crickets chirp, cicadas chirping, and little insects chirping, and little insects buzzing around, and it's flowers are blooming. You know, it's so peaceful and quiet. Just let it sink in that way, playing golf. I'd be willing to do that. In fact, I am willing to do it. I'm capable of doing this. So I've proved to myself I'm capable of doing this. But I don't want to spend 5 hours on Facebook a day, you know? No, I don't. No way. So let's see what happens. I believe it could happen this way. If it gets green lighted. So what do I do today? Well, I guess I'll work out some more. Worked out a lot yesterday. And feel okay. Feel okay, you know. But we'll see what I can do today. All right. Wow. That's enough. Let it sink in.